It's a privilege that you are here today. Dr. Dileep, he is an orthopedic spine surgeon, has done a lot of surgeries in Visakhapatnam and in different places in Kolkata and Mumbai, and he went to many countries. So the introductory part and about him, definitely he'll explain to you, because medical terminology and the way he expresses definitely will go to your brains, because every day we are speaking and definitely we are old faces to you. So the new face will speak to you. Very good morning to the director and other faculty members who are here. So let us not waste the time. And sir, our students having a lot of questions related to this nutrition and this pipe. Before hand over to you, my student will give a little introduction to everyone. Please welcome.
Good morning,
Ananda.
Respected
chief guest,
dear CMD madam, dear
CMD
sir. Learn teachers and my beloved peers, let me introduce myself to you. I am Josna from FY19. I am pursuing BSc Food Science and Nutrition in several educational institutions. As we all know, we have gathered here for doctor's meet. And the chief guest is being today is Dr. B. Sai Dileep. And let me give you a brief introduction about her honored guest. Dr. B. Sai Dileep is a neuro spine surgeon from Vishaka Multi Speciality Clinics. He is a honor fellow in minimally invasive spine surgery, South Korean in interventional pain, MRCS from Edinburgh, FIPT from Germany, endoscopic spin surgeon fellow in stem cell generative therapy, Boston, USA. As an endoscopic spine surgeon, operated more than 3,500 surgeries concentrating lumbar, cervical and thoracic regions, specialist in regenerative and stem cell treatments. Specialist in sciatica and cervical spondylitis. Specialist in treating frozen shoulders. Specialist in laser spine surgery or single day discharge spine surgery. His other attendant services provided to his specialization. We welcome you to our college wholeheartedly.
Thank you very much. Wonderful introduction. We welcome Principal Madam Dr. Vijayalakshmi Garu, sir, she is the principal of our academy. Sir, now our students will speak to you and they have a lot of questions. Before they speak, a little introduction about you on your own. If you talk to them, if you tell them about the proceedings of the treatments and all, about the patients and generally what you faced and how you are here today. A little introduction in 2-3 minutes, that will be great for all the students. Thank you.
Good morning, friends. Nice to see you all. It's really a privilege to come here and talk with your beloved CMD, sir. No, see, the thing is, being into a specialty of medical field is a different entity. And encouraging the other fields which will support the field to grow into a next level is very important, which your CMD sir is doing for new clinical nutrition, dietics. They are going to play a major role in the coming future. So coming to my specialty, yes, I was a trained qualified orthopedic surgeon initially. So then I went for my super specialty in spine surgery. So it was a long journey. Then I started learning endoscopic surgeries in Korea. Then I worked there for 1 year. Then you know, I feel like doing more. So I traveled down to Germany, to Hamburg, and worked under Professor Rupen. He's one of the world's finest spine surgeons in St. Anne Hospital in Hamburg. Then my idea of surgery has changed with a small statement. This is going to give a good picture to you all. Once I met a great doctor who is a famous cardiothoracic surgeon. So he's around 75 years old. So when I met him, he was just telling me that. So I was saying he's the pioneer for doing heart transplant surgeries. He's around 76 years old. He has just told me, I have done around 450 heart transplants. So I just said, you are such a great man. So he just told me a single word. If I knew that, if I can treat patients by preventing their salt intake and keeping BP controlled and making them perfect, so I could have saved 450 million people. So it's not the greatness of treating patients. It's how you are going to mount the patient. So that's where your field plays a major role. So this is my basic introduction about what I do. So other aspects, it's not quite important to you. So I'll give you time so that my ideas may help you for something for your growth.
Thank you very much. Before students ask the questions, let us see a few photographs while sir doing surgeries. And then we have to see how great he is doing 3,500 surgeries. Means it's not easy. So let's see a few pictures before asking the questions. Thank you.
So this is the brief introduction which you have already known regarding our chief guest, sir. So it is actually a great honor, sir. So you have achieved a lot during your career, and we are pleased to see your achievements. So these pictures are actually a privilege. We will not get such pictures easily. Why? Because these are the pictures taken in an operation theater. So nowadays there are lot of technological advancements are there. Okay, so the bioinstrumentation is also developing a lot, and this is actually allowing the expert physicians to operate the spinal problems or any health related problems with more accuracy and precision.
Most of the students, by watching these pictures, you may feel that it's the job of a doctor. But after the surgery, when the patients recovered, that will be the happiness of the family. So, how we have to appreciate all these doctors, we understand after COVID. You know, most of the surgeries are done at COVID time. So, a lot of doctors hesitated to do surgeries because of the COVID, but he is the person has done a lot of surgeries at that COVID time, and a lot of patients, when they called to him in that COVID time, he provided the remdesivir injection which is not available in the market. So that initiation he has taken to save the patients. Generally doctors do treatment for the 10 days, 15 days and they leave them, but if a patient goes to him, he will be his family member for the life. That way he's treating all the patients. So now it's a time for you, my dear students. So all the questions, whatever you ask, definitely he will answer all the questions. Thank you.
So glad to be here to have an opportunity to ask a question for you. Sir, nowadays many people are suffering from sciatica problem now, sir. What is your advice to them to get rid of that?
So all the questions you ask me, I give you two answers. You can call me like split personality. One answer as a doctor, one answer as a common man. So sciatica is a common word. Sciatica implies that you have a pain. It sciatica came from word, it's actually from Latin, which implies that the nerve pain comes from somewhere is a problem and the nerve starts crying. So sciatica doesn't imply only the back, it's hurting, it's coming down to the legs or is the neck. It also implies the neck, there's a problem in the neck, the pain comes through to the hands. Or if it's the pain in the upper back, which comes to the chest. Any pain which is coming from the spine, going to the lower limb or the upper limb, comes under sciatica. But since it was first diagnosed with the sciatic nerve is sciatic nerve is the thickest nerve of the body, which comes from the L4, L5, the lower part of the spine. So that is why we call it sciatica. Sciatica is nothing but radiation of pain to the problem is somewhere and the symptoms are somewhere. When the patient will have problem in the back, but the patient complains of pain in the neck. So the pain usually increases by walking, sitting, like students who sit for longer time. The patient develops initially cramps, shooting pain, sometimes current shocks, sometimes they can't walk, they can't bend their legs, and if they walk for a few meters, they feel the leg is becoming numb. This is what sciatica is. According to as a doctor, you ask me, this is what. So as a colloquial language, as a non-doctor, what you want to learn about sciatica is what you should take care of. There are two kinds of muscles in the body. One muscle, when you want to work, it works. Just like your biceps. You want to lift something, you lift, the muscle gets contract. So that's how you lift weights or you do some work. So there are some other muscles called anti-gravity muscles or passive muscles, just like your biceps. So when you use your bicep, the bicep becomes flaccid. So similarly, the back muscles are constantly working when you are sitting or standing. So people who are not maintaining a good posture, the people who are basically having osteoporosis or weakness in the back because of low calcium levels or dietary weakness or nutritional deficiencies, people who are having genetically conditions like arthritis in the spine, so they are all prone for the muscles to be weak, and their wrong posture aggravates this thing. So when you take as a spine is like building, and the walls are, spine is like the pillars and the walls are the muscles. So both play a very major role. People just think the spine is important. So people who don't take care of the back, the muscles if are not maintained well, so obviously the patient will develop problems because of the weight bearing on the spine. So just see, this is a box. If the box, the contour is maintaining well, you put a 50 kg dumbbell on it, that box won't break. But if you have a small crack in the box or the box has lost its strength, so a 5 kg weight will collapse the box. The same thing is with the spine. So what happens is once you are developing or having early signs of sciatica, means early signs of sciatica is not always the neck pain. It's always the low back pain, which is non-specific. Right? You don't know when the back pain is coming, when the back pain will increase, or when the back pain will come down. So constantly you'll have a lagging back pain, which will be torturing you a lot. So when these symptoms have started, you need to consult a doctor, or you should change your posture, you should do your back strengthening exercises. You should see how is your nutrition going around. You should see whether you're developing in calcium or vitamin D3 deficiencies. So if these things have been taken care of and posture is maintained, 90% of sciatica can be taken care of. But the only problem is sciatica can't be taken care of if it's already the patient is developing nerve weakness. That is a technical job of a doctor, we'll take care of. But initially, for your knowledge, it's a nutritional balance, physical activity, constant physical activity, and maintenance of posture.
I'm Preeti from FN20. It's a great opportunity to us to ask you a question directly. Now, my question to you, sir. Actually, brushing with non-dominant hand will affect the brain function. How about the effects?
Yeah. So, yeah, this question is good for me, but if I give the answer, it will be confusing for you. See, the brain is such a beautiful thing. So the domination of the brain is quite complex, which still has not yet been understood. So right dominance, left dominance is very different. See, I have left hand or vice versa. So my right dominance is there. But the brain has divided, the God has created such a way that few functions which are important for the brain, for the body, are equally distributed to the right and left. So it implies all. See, some walking, memory stays in one part of the brain, long-term memory and short-term memory stays in frontal part of the brain. There are multiple things. Your reading capacity, long-term memory goes to other part of the brain. Your posture, standing, you walking straight line, these are maintained with basic ganglia in the lower part of the brain. So domination of the brain implies that patients, even that's common with the heart. So usually it's a genetic preponderance that you have some part of the brain to be more active for each individualist person. So if your right brain is quite active, your left hands are quite strong. If your left brain is quite active, your right hands are more strong. So that's how your left hand or right handedness is determined. So once you ask me a question, how it is going to help? Non-dominant hand helping you play. So there is a beautiful concept discovered by a few Germans called as neuroplasticity. Plasticity is a concept which is going to play a major role for you in the nutrition. Once the brain losing its function, once the brain is becoming weak, or once the brain is affected by a stroke or something, the nerves, what you call as the neurons, which are the basic structure, like your first bricks of a wall, they try to, these are all wires, they are just current wires. They try to reconnect themselves to circuits and they make you more active. So they try to regain the minimum balance or minimum capacity what you were before. So this neuroplasticity is the one which will happen from birth to your death. So aging, all the body parts can regenerate, but except nerves. Once the nerves are born, they grow, they become dead, they're dead. There is no regeneration in the nerves, which is still in the quite early level of research. Because I'm in regenerative medicine, I know about these things. So regeneration of nerves is not yet discovered. But neuroplastination is nothing but your brain's taking up the other brain's activity, is quite it's educated in the new science. So when you use your non-dominant hand for improving your doing your brushing and all, how it affects your brain? It won't affect your brain. You're just training your monkey brain to do it. So obviously a day will come, you may become ambidextrous. Ambidextrous means you can use both your hands. So there's nothing bad is going to happen. You can use a non-dominant hand. But only it's your habit. You're habituated to brush, so you will do it that. So you obviously do it, you feel weak, so you don't feel doing it. So if you're really doing it, you're doing good for you. You're not destroying your brain cells. So there is an old concept in the younger generation where your left hand, it's a mistake, they hit you and they change you to right hand. So that doesn't make any difference. So only thing is you're making your really dominant brain weak to weak. So you do it. You try doing your non-dominant brushing. So maybe next year if I see you, you may be thinking more clever.
How to prevent the muscle atrophy in pediatric children and in future any problems?
There are two things in the brain, not in the brain, in the body. These two are very important for you as a clinical nutritionist. One is called as catabolic phenomena, one is called as anabolic phenomena. Anabolic phenomena is the last bench boys. They are in the age of the anabolic phenomena, where their hormones are quite well. So whatever they eat, the plate of biryani they eat, that will be definitely going into the muscle. So if you see a person who is having a chronic condition, like his cancer, cirrhosis, some kind of liver failure, some all kind of diseases, so they go into some phenomenon called catabolism. So I'll basically tell you which answers everything about the muscle weaknesses. One is anabolic phenomena is, anabolic means whatever you eat, the protein you eat, they just break into molecules in your stomach called amino acids. They get attached together. These attachments together, they become muscle. So that when you exercise with eating it, so obviously the muscle grows. So anabolic phenomena, though you don't exercise, maybe at your, that is now it is losing it because of your obesity. Childhood obesity has increased because of that. But previously, like your fathers or great fathers who used to work in the farms, until 45, their anabolic levels were fine. Means when whatever they eat, they are working out some kind of physical job. So everything turns up into the muscle and there will be no wastage of muscle. So what is catabolism? Catabolism is nothing but breakdown of protein. So breakdown is just whatever you take it, that won't be converted to the muscle. So it just breaks into multiple pieces and goes through your kidney or through your washout to the washout. So catabolic phenomena happens mainly because of a few common things called obesity, less physical activity, and of course all chronic conditions. Chronic conditions like anything, cancer, chronic kidney disease, liver diseases, any condition which is debilitating, which will end up with a bad. So they obviously the brain is so sick, the body is so sick. So it stops taking about the protein content into the body. So this ideal unequivocal. So unequivocal is just to show off that I know English. But it's not like that. Unequivocal means it's just a balance between catabolism and anabolism is the success of anti-aging. So any muscle endopathies, any wasting, any as a nutritionist, you should take care of the calorie intake. You should see that the calories are not simple carbohydrates. With simple carbohydrates break down and also cause gluconeogenesis, which means the protein breaks down into glucose again. So these are all the conditions where the muscle will be losing its capacity. So any pediatric endopathies, whether it's genetically modulated or it is nutritionally modulated, you know, nutritional endopathies are more common than what you ask as endopathies. Because nutritional endopathies, like you heard about kwashiorkor, marasmus, so those are the conditions or nutritional diseases where you end up, the body is in a catabolic state, though you give them calorie intake, they don't take up the thing. So they, what happens is the protein is low, so all the fluid accumulates and they look like the same faces you see. So any kind of endopathy, whether they need to recover or not, whether it's genetically modulated or not modulated, our concept of treating a disease depends upon two things. One, finding out the root cause. If it is really a genetic cause, definitely we can't help it. But two, definitely physical therapy and nutritional therapy. They play a major role in preventing the progression of the disease. I think I answered you, or I need to be more complex.
Yes, sir. It's clear, sir. Thank you.
Why lean people bend quickly in younger ages?
Bend quickly? What do you mean by bend quickly? They can bend easily, or they become you mean like bamboo spine, they are going to bend like that? It's not like that. Nowadays, my gut feeling, it's my perspective of the patient is, if he is lean, I'm happy. Yeah, definitely being lean is good. Lean people don't bend easily. It's the amount of the muscle which they have which will cause the posture deformity. Bending down is mainly because of your wrong posture than your health. So lean, fat, yeah, fat of course it's a different entity. Lean, quite heavy, strengthy or non-strengthy, it doesn't really impact your posture. Posture means the way you stand or way you sit. It is always how you train your brain. So I don't feel like lean people do need to bend quickly until unless you have so much of weakness in your body where the muscle is quite weak. You are also having some hormonal abnormalities. You also have in situ calcium deficiency and all. So my gut feeling is still you be lean is good enough. Don't try to become like me and run to the gym. So it's better being lean is good enough is my gut feeling.
Can I ask another question?
Yes, yes.
What are the spinal problems occurring due to pregnancy?
Why? Yeah. See, spine is the center of gravity of your body. Center of gravity is just like the main basement of the building. So obviously, if your weight is 50 kgs, if she weighs 50 kgs, you weigh 50 kgs, your spine takes up a load of about 2.5 into 3 times the body weight. So 150 kgs to 125 kgs of body weight will be always falling on your back. So when you're pregnancy, there are two things happening. One, you have a large stomach, so that itself will pull the spine back, and you try to carry your back, which you don't want. You want to support your back, so obviously you use your back to have no strength. So you know, in Indian population, when you become pregnant, you ask the lady to stop doing exercise. You ask the lady not to walk. You ask the lady not to sit, not to sleep, or whatever the things your mom tells, she follows it. So the soberness, laziness itself is the cause of back pain. So you can ask me a question in a different way. How can you prevent back pain in a pregnant woman? So I will definitely give you the idea of how you can prevent it. We can prevent it with good nutrition, yes, and physical strengthening exercises, back flexibility exercises, and the most common thing is pregnant women are prone for chronic urinary infections. So urinary infections will cause something called a problem in this, you know, the hip joints, the hip is the commonest thing which affects because of urinary infection. So that hips become stiff. So the stiffness of the hip, one starts, that stays for a longer time. So they complain of the back pain. So early assessment of these conditions, yeah, we can prevent back pain in pregnancy. This is all, it's a multimodal thinking than a specific doctor thing. It includes nutrition, physical therapy, which will prevent back pain in pregnancy. And yeah, after the surgery, usually these people link up that spine, they got anesthesia done and they have back pain. That is really non-specific, like my gut feeling is.
And what is the food required for spinal growth?
It's a good question. Again, this answer is a quite a cumulative thing which you ask very common. There is not specifically nutritional supplementation for spine. Once we know the patient is developing a spine issue, we try to go retrospective, means go back into the future, not future, just see what are the causes. So if I see you, you look quite fine. So yeah, so if you look quite healthy to me. But if you develop back pain, definitely I may think about that. I go retrospective. Prospective is going forward. Retrospective, what you're studying is prospective study. You go to study this, go to your specialty, you go get a good job. Retrospective is I go to your S2 and know what is the cause. So yeah, retrospective naturally I can see whether what are the common causes of back pain. The commonest cause for back pain is long-term calcium deficiency, vitamin D3 deficiency, which science has proved that it may cause a trouble. Other than that, active muscles. So your brain tries to know that whatever food you take, some amount should be kept for your muscle growth, until unless you have a disease. That's what I was telling you, catabolism and anabolism. So if you're anabolically active, you don't need to worry about your muscle until unless you're sitting for 18 hours for your last bench and play your PUBG. That's what I was doing in my college days. So that's how you be like, then definitely your muscle becomes quite weak and you end up with troubles. But there is no specific nutritional supplementation to increase the or decrease the back pain. It is only, we should find out the root cause. If you are prone for vitamin D3 deficiency, definitely I refer to you. You take care of the supplementation, you take care of what all the required. So yeah, definitely the nutritional supplementation, if it prevents the deficiency, the patient recovers. But there is no something, always balanced diet is required for everyone, which you know as basics. So your calorie content, your carbohydrate content, your protein content, your multivitamin content, or there is something called RDA. What is RDA? Recommended daily. So your RDA values you try to maintain, you try to take care of these things. Those are good enough to prevent the further damage of your things. But if I develop back pain and you try to resolve with only nutrition, it won't be so easy. So then, first answer, I'll be jobless.
Myself, Vairasri, I'm from PSC Food and Nutrition. This is a precious opportunity to us to clarify our doubts with you. I would like to ask you one question. Why the leg cramps and frequent twisting during sleep?
You feel cramps and you feel restless. It means you feel, you sleep straight, you feel you need to turn the legs to the right side, to the left. You don't feel like sleeping comfortable in one position. You mean like that? Science, there is a different entity called restless leg syndrome. Restless leg syndrome is a common entity for few people with a condition called chronic fatigue syndrome. Chronic fatigue means fatigue is you getting tired. Chronic fatigue syndrome is you are fatigued always. You always feel weak, you always feel lethargic, you always feel not feeling to work. That is because of some problem in the molecular level in the body. That will mimic restless legs. Cramps can be basically a tiredness or electrolyte imbalance because of your dehydration. You run in the morning, you lose a lot of sweat and you lose your sodium and potassium from your body. So definitely you end up with cramps. You have a big bout of diarrhea, so you obviously will have cramps. And cramps for longer time is also a symptom of calcium deficiency and also vitamin B12 deficiency, the most commonest causes. Rarest causes of cramps are there and restlessness are there, like chronic fatigue syndrome, sciaticas, and there are something called neuropathies. The nerve gets damaged by itself. There is something called monoaxonal neuropathies, polyaxonal neuropathies. These are what implies the nerve loses its capacity by itself. So those conditions, you may feel these kind of things, but basic causes to rule out. And you know, you people who don't work also will have cramps. So my ideology is if you start getting cramps, first you try to walk for half an hour and get your legs stressed out and try to sleep. If the cramps are aggravating, then we'll try to see the root cause. But my feeling is cramps specifically, I can't give you a specific.
During sleep.
You're tired, maybe? No. Your age is too young to be tired, I think. So your age is not. So I don't feel the cause of cramps for you is specific nutritional deficiencies.
It happens sometimes during sleep. At midnight.
You feel like your roommate has your legs. I feel always. That's okay for you, I think. You don't need too much worry about it at the present moment. Otherwise I'll give a visiting card, you can be my first patient from Southern. I don't think you need such kind of treatment at the present moment. So my basic idea is vitamin B12 is adequate. You are vegetarian? You are vegetarian? You are vegetarian? You don't eat non-veg? No, I'm asking. Where? So the problem is vitamin B12 is more in the non-veg state. So the B12 deficiency itself may cause cramps. So probably a vegetarian is dangerous. I should not advocate like that. But you can supplement with vitamin B12 if required. Cramps in the night, very non-specific. It usually happens if you're tired, or it happens if you're not tired also, or it happens if you're dehydrated also. So initial day of cramps, what we ask them is take plenty of fluids, if not AORS, and ultrate imbalance we try to correct, and we see how the cramps are resolving. Then we ask them to walk and see. If these things are not are improving, we give them vitamin B12, and chronic fatigue, we find out if she is prone to that, she feels lethargic from day and morning to night. Then we give some food supplementation like L-carnitine and L-carnitine. So these kind of things we try. But if these things all fail, then we find out the root cause of the cramps. You have back pain?
Yes,
so that can be the cause of the cramps. So maybe I am successful coming here to see my patient. No, the cramps, what you get at your age, at the present moment, try to do some back strengthening exercises, do a regular walk, maintain your posture, the things will resolve faster. We'll see. Growth spurts in adolescent is a commonest cause of back pain. So until 11 or 12, the growth spurt is different. From 12 to 18, the growth spurt is different. So there is unbalanced growth spurt for few people. It means the back becomes quite tall or the hips become quite tall. So the abnormal mismatch between the growth in the spine, so not your height, I'm telling people are quite tall. So the abnormal height growth may definitely may cause these kind of conditions, non-specific back pains, which will resolve with nutritional therapy and physical therapy. So until unless it is not genetically mediated, there are conditions like ankylosing spondylitis and rheumatoid arthritis, which will be presenting in the second decade, means 20 or 30s age group, where you need to rule out, but that presents with stiffness. Morning when you wake up, you feel quite stiff in the back. So if that is not there, these are the most commonest. It's only growth spurt. Until 21, sudden high growth, sudden weight gain, they may develop into back pain. And for women, your menstrual irregularities will cause estrogen deficiency, will cause some amount of calcium deficiency. It may also cause
and my question is, how paralysis and spine are connected?
Spine is something kind of a switchboard from the brain. So switchboard, the main in your college building is the brain. The switchboard you have in your classroom is the spine. It is called the relay point. Relay point is, it takes up the signal, it also sends the signal to the peripheral parts. So the brain sends a signal to move your hand, it sends a signal to the spine. So this cervical spine supplies to the hands, the lumbar spine supplies to the legs. So God has created so fascinatingly our nervous system. See, if the problem is completely in every control is the upper spine, the injury would have destroyed our whole spine. So but he has distributed so well that the relay points are quite different. So any problem in the spine, like it can be just a small sciatic pain which is neglected, or most common cause of paralysis, fractures in the spine. Most common fractures are due to road traffic accident. The fractured bone comes and cuts off the spinal cord. So depending on the level of area which the spinal cord has been cut, that will cause the paralysis. So spinal cord causing paralysis is most commonly due to injuries. But rarely there are conditions like transverse myelitis, multiple myelomas or genetic conditions which may end up with paralysis, but those are little rare. Yeah, but spinal cord is a relay point for all these conditions. So people who develop paralysis, we should definitely rule out the spine problem for sure. And usually the paralysis, because the spine is very different. If it is in the upper part of the spine, you feel the both legs will be paralyzed. If it is in the neck, the four legs will be paralyzed. If it is in the lower part of the leg, spine, it may be a single leg, but the both legs can be paralyzed.
Okay. Can you explain the effects of marriages among close relatives on spinal problems?
Spinal problems or only normally marriages?
Marriages
in your own family. Like your own man, uncle, man, mom, children, and all, you marry. So you mom and dad carry the mom and your brother carry the same amount of gene. So the gene going to the family, usually the genes which are not dominant, there are two things. The gene which is quite complex in few things, but easily I tell you. The genes what you carry, if you carry the problem gene with you, since your related husband is also carrying the same gene, your children, if he gets the both, if he's a female, if he's XY gene, so you carry that gene and he or she carries the both the genes, then definitely the disease is quite common for them. So concerning marriages, if you can say that why if I marry the other children, people, why this is less? Because there are most of the diseases are two patterns. One is dominant pattern and other is recessive pattern. Recessive pattern means the person to get the disease, he should have both the genes to express the disease. For dominant pattern, one gene is enough to express the disease. So that's why if you not marry a known family also, you see some children getting some kind of problems. But if you marry a known person, if you are carrying that kind of any gene which causes genetic diseases, it will be coming quite commonly. You understand? So the ratio of risk, if it is 1:10,000 for normal marriage, this will become 1:400. So if you are unlucky, you may get it. So that's why genetic issues are common in consanguineous marriages. So we do take care of these conditions. So I as a doctor, I say, you know, it's not better. You have anyone waiting for you to get married? No, better don't do that. So it's not going to reward you well. So as a doctor or as a good friend to you, as we are educated enough in the science background, no consanguineous marriage. You ask me related to spine? Yeah, it's a big disease. Because it's a book. There are genetic diseases of spine, around 40-50 cases, which are linked with genetic preponderance. Among that, around 6 to 7 conditions like ankylosing spondylitis, which I told, will come to the family. So, yeah, 2-3 conditions will aggravate in consanguineous, if it is specific to spine. But you make it as a whole, there are n number of diseases which are going to come out. So, yeah, better don't marry. You go for a other marriage, it's better for you.
Good morning, sir. I'm Yogita from BSc Food Technology. Sir, I have a question. Why does prolactin levels increase, sir?
Prolactin is a hormone which is linked to multiple things. There is something called GnRH which is produced from the brain, which will increase the prolactin during pregnancy to increase your lactation. But even there are some other conditions like tumors in the brain, the prolactin levels will increase. Tumors in the breast, which will, the prolactin levels will increase. Normally, prolactin level increases for you. If you are not pregnant, you are not lactating, definitely it's a problem. We should find out the cause why it is rising. But it won't rise normally. No. Prolactin is only required for a woman during her lactation, during pregnancy. We do give prolactin. Actually, one more thing is, prolactin is also, prevents you to reproduce again. So prolactin prevents formation of ovum. So that's why it's a natural reproductive barrier for pregnancy. You know, Indian population, if you get the children to next month, they can become again pregnant. But God has created prolactin to prevent that. So until you are breastfeeding, you won't become pregnant because of that. So that's the role of prolactin. But specifically prolactin raising, no, usually it doesn't raise. If it's raising, it's alarming. We should find out the cause. There should be some hormone that is implanted in your brain, ovaries, or some kind of thing. Definitely nutrition has a role which is 80-90% more important than what we treat. We are not the saviors, we are only you are the preventive people for the patients to go into such kind of deficiencies. So we are the one, we only treat the deficiencies. See, that's what I told the story, you didn't catch it. So I was in this stage of superego when we finished my studies and you feel like you have finished your education. Coming to practice, when I was in Germany, I'll repeat the story, it plays a very important role. I met a great heart surgeon called Kenneth Candido. He's quite a big man, 74 years old man, who has done around 450 heart transplants.
So when I met him, he operates heart transplant for 17 hours. So he has saved 450 lives. He's a great man. Proud to meet. It's an honor to meet him. So I was praising him. You know, Indians, we praise them. We just we want to get the attention to become that they're good. So I was doing this odd stuff. So he said that I'm not really proud about it. What he said was, if I knew that in my 70s, if I am a community medicine specialist, that I could have prevented these heart conditions by regular follow-up with BP medication, sugar control, with salt medication, with nutritional problems, thyroid deficiency, cardiac failures. So such kind of conditions, if I knew that in the base level preventive therapy, I would have saved 450 million people. 450 is nothing. 450 dying is not a big issue. Only affordable people go for it. But 450 million if you have saved, it's a big thing. No? So nutrition is the same thing for you. So nutrition has enormously grown. So once you work in a bigger center, when we work in a bigger center, like, it's not saying that Vizag is not mentally developed. So it's not diversified. So diversified implies two things. One, the specialty should be respected. So in, when you work in, I was in Edinburgh and all, the nutritional branch is very much respected. Respected means your role of your therapy is quite important for multiple conditions. So it is whether it's preoperatively making the cardiac patient fit for surgery or postoperatively for the cardiac patient to be fit to recover and walk back home, or for a cancer patient to take up his chemotherapy, or a spine surgeon to operate him and make the muscle strength, gain back his strength. These all conditions are quite mediated by the nutritional therapies. So nutritional therapy is diversified now into multiple branches. Nutrition therapy and dietics are so diversified now. Like dietics is, one is lifestyle modification dietics, means like your hypertensive diet, cardiovascular diet, diabetic diet. And you have so many conditions, ketogenic diets, non-ketogenic diets, healthy diets, that doesn't work. It's only low-calorie diets. So low-calorie diets, these all things are diversified in one field. One is the lifestyle modification diet. One is nutritional therapy during the perioperative period. Perioperative period includes preoperative surgery, operative time, and post-operative time. So this perioperative nutrition for a patient to cope up major surgeries. If the patient has undergone a major esophageal surgery, not for spine. Spine is quite easy, madam. Sorry for that. I'm concentrating on the other concepts. Because spine, the stomach is not affected. I'm just operating the back. So usually the uptake is normal. Until unless I fail myself, he will eat his food. So if the patients undergo major bowel resections. Bowel is nothing but your stomach. The stomach surgeries, you go, they develop a lot of conditions like small bowel loop syndromes, long bowel loop syndromes, dumping syndrome. Means the stomach, you take the big bowel, the food directly dumps from the stomach into the smaller intestine. So there is, you know, the stomach is the lining where the B12 will be absorbed. You know, the ileum is the line where there are few things will be absorbed. Duodenum is the line where the other things are absorbed. These all things come down. So these nutrient deficiencies are very well neglected in the present population. So perioperative major abdominal surgeries, major cancer surgeries, major brain tumor surgeries, paralysis patients, where the patients are cachexic. Cachexic means catabolism in the severe form is called cachexia. In cancer and paralyzed patient, you see that because the patient doesn't eat, whatever he eats, it won't assimilate into energy. The patient, because you know, you see like skeletons. So this type, the nutrition plays a very major role. So perioperative success of the surgery for bowel surgeries, nutrition is very important. That is one diversification. The other diversification for nutrition is ICU nutrition. ICU nutrition is very important where you go for a complex surgery, where we go for total parenteral nutrition, where you give nutrition from the injections. There is something called parenteral nutrition, where you put a tube in the mouth, you see the patient's catabolic state, and you give them nutrition. There is post-operative nutrition, we give it. So these all things have diversified so well. So lifestyle nutrition, you can take it as a separate branch. You can become a lifestyle coach, because if you know exactly what, how you know the metabolic activity of the person is assessed. Why do most diets fail? Can you explain anyone? Why do diets fail? People see you are obese, you feel like losing weight. Why don't you lose weight? I'll tell you the answer. I think you don't have time for that. So diets fail because nutrition is a very specific. Now, the new science says that the body has two brains. One in the brain, the other in the stomach. These both are not interconnected. Your stomach has a different brain. It also releases the same chemicals like what is released in your brain. All the dopamine, all the serotonin, all the pleasure hormone. You are very happy, you feel like eating a biryani. You friends go to a movie, what do you say? You feel like you go and eat a biryani. Why do you feel that? Because the mental rush you got, they release the dopamine in your body. Dopamine will increase the secretion in the stomach. So you feel like eating. Why do you eat in the hostel? You feel like eating, anything is okay. These things are, they are very multimodally, they are not much thought about it. But the research is still going quite well. And there will be a day when nutrition plays a major role in lot of conditions. I'll tell you an example, few conditions, how people recover very well. I have a patient who has undergone a major bypass of all the abdominal organs because of cancer, colon. So the nutrition, he has been done with a dumping syndrome. So all the food is going to the stomach, is directly dumped into the lower intestine. So there was deficiency and he started developing leg weakness. So the treating gastroenterologist surgeon was not thinking much about it, just he has given multivitamins. But ideal nutritionist was thinking about high fiber, low calorie, right? Low calorie, how it should be maintained, and how the protein content should be maintained, how frequently the protein should be given, what is the interval between the protein because of the diabetic status to prevent. If you give suddenly protein, the body doesn't take up, it ends into it and just breaks into glucose. So these are all the multiple things which have changed into the future. So definitely, it is so big, nutritional therapy is so big. There are big courses now in UK, you offer PhD in even industrial nutrition, nutraceutical nutrition. These are multiple branches where you need to prefer to go into. So this is a stepping stone and you need to search for the opportunities. In my days, there was no specific spine surgery. So I was searching for the opportunities and yeah, luck picked me or something, but we were learning something. So similarly, nutrition, yes, we can do good work if you know what you want to do in. So you enter your nutritional BSc, you enter your second year or third year. I should be fixed. Either I need to be a physician or I need to be a surgeon. So similarly, you should be fixed. You are good in speaking. You're good in talking. You can become a lifestyle coach. You can give diets. You know, people, the big senior industry people hire dietitians for lakhs of rupees. So that's your gene to learn the nutritional concepts that keeps you ahead. So yeah, that has a huge future for treating multiple conditions. Since I'm a spine surgeon, you're very specific to spine. But it is specific to every condition. So whatever conditions you are dealing with, any hormonal abnormalities. You know you can treat 80% of the women who are obese, PCOD, nutritional differences. You can treat it with a good amount of diets. You can prevent getting arthritis by preventing red meat. So this why does diet play so major role? The diet should be concentrated by you people. So you people interlinking the disease will give you more edge over other people. So that's all. Nutrition is a very important thing. Of course, I appreciate nutrition. So you should, you ask me how I should be focused enough. Focus should be from your side. Focus is like, you should have the edge where I should stand. Like, you want to end up with a nutritionist, it's good enough. You want to end up with a nutritionist that begins to, for industrial purpose, a chocolate factory where you're going to do the regular calorie intake, calorie, you know, the burns and check the calorie burns and all. You find out that's also good. So you're going to the research side, going to the nutraceutical side for checking out the RDA levels and you're feeling new nutraceuticals are come down and going to the research side, that's also good. You want to become your initial aspect of a being doctor, you like treating patients, you want to treat chronically ill conditions, yeah, that's good. You can become a clinical nutritionist. Everything has a major goal now. But now at the present scenario, every field has equal number of people. So you need to be diversified. Diversified means your focus should be the end point than the early point. Early point basement should be strong, the end point should be focused on the first day. So then the things will be quite good for you. That's my ideology.
Sir, now I have a question. So all my students, they have a lot of questions. Most of the students who joined in Southern education institutions, they wrote their MCAT and couldn't be able to get a seat in medicine. So they have chosen this food science and nutrition and food technology programs. So most of the parents in the states of both Telugu states, Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, they are thinking that so doctor is the best always, but nutritionist or food technologist, why we have to choose this normal degree program? This is the general opinion in the public. In that situation, we are developing these programs by inviting a lot of students. So they have different opinions on this. So my request is, on your opinion, what will be the future of these nutritionists or the food technologists, and what is the scope of development, and will really India will look at these people in future? Or the medicines are developing every day, hospitals are developing every day. How well this nutrition plays a role in treating the patient in ICU or in the hospitals? And is it really the patient recovers very soon with the help of the diet plans what the nutritionist is giving? So all of these doubts most of the students are having, and they're having a doubt what will be the future. And what suggestion you will give it to the next generations, the students who completed their plus two now, or next year maybe after plus two, they'll think about these nutritional programs or the food technology program. And can they take such kind of programs, or will they have the future? Most of the students have this question. So on your words, if you tell them, that will be a great advantage for them, because they're waiting. Who will give the best answer, because they're going to all the layman's where they don't have the knowledge. They'll ask their relatives or friends, can I become a nutritionist? Means they're degrading them. See, you have best options, why you are selecting these programs? So here my question is, instead of asking these layman's where they don't have knowledge, it's today really our privilege, our Southernites all have the privilege, and tomorrow's generation also will have the privilege if you give the best answer. What exactly will be there in India, what India is looking, especially about these programs. So on your words.
Most of the things I answered previously, I told you why nutrition plays a major role. Yeah, but I'll give you a concise report how it works. It is always perspective of our individuality to know what we are. It is not for the society what we are living for. So I had this gut feeling I wanted to become a neurosurgeon. I didn't get it. So it's okay. But the perspective of your individuality will give you success. You see a dabbawala who starts a business in a small canteen, who has grown into multi-model growth business. So the perception of your work, if you are very much interested, success automatically comes down to any kind of field. So that is the final answer for most of the things. But while coming to nutrition, sir didn't force me to come down. I said, sir, I'm very much interested to come down because of this reason. The future, we see medically or developmental wise, India is blooming on par with the world, on par the world with all kind of technologies. We are going in a good way. So after, maybe I'm not so much exposed, but roaming around 4-5 countries, seeing how things work, how the cumulative approach for a success of patient works. Why do people run down to UK for a surgery? Why do people run down to US for surgery? Why do people run down to Korea for a surgery? So you see, the putting the blade is the same, talking to the patient is the same, the treating the surgery is also the same. Why we are getting good results? There are small things which play a major role. Nutrition is been considered as a very effective field in the outer part of the world. Definitely, yes. I told you that they are considered as individual consultants in the ICU, in the hospitals, and those field is not mitigated by the doctor. Means if any person is not getting mitigated in their profession, means if I'm treating something, some other comes and disturbs him, so obviously your field is downgraded, you feel disturbed. So that is possible even in engineering. You know, you have a chief, you have a super chief. But once you are a consultant to any kind of field, you should be quite happy. the inner engineering should be developed. The only thing is you should develop your skills. That gives you the extra edge. But being as individual consultant, you are taking up your own decision. So definitely this is a field you should have your highest regard for. Because, yeah, I told you 6 or 7 diversified branches where nutrition is developing to a quite a higher level. Even industrial level, commercial level, even hospital sector and hospitality sector also. You see, there are 7-star hotels and 6-star hotels. We go to conferences, they serve me a meal. The meal has been collected by a nutritionist. There is a big spa around in Vizag, Pima. There is a resort with a charge around 4.5 lakhs per week for detoxing your body, where a clinical nutritionist takes care of your all the supplementation, all your ideal things which you're losing, what are the deficiencies you're anticipated. They go to monitor, they check your calcium, magnesium, electrolytes, heavy metals in your body, they do detoxes. So yeah, definitely future of a nutritionist as a consultant, if it is respected, you can happily be proud that you are a nutritionist, because your field is not mitigated by anyone. Your field is only accepting for the other person to get the good result. Means I want a good result from a person, from a patient. I take your help so that he will be comfortable. So me taking your help as a consultant for helping you is definitely a reward for you personally and prospectively as an individual also. So individual happiness is there. It doesn't imply you are world best neurosurgeon or you are just a MBBS doctor treating hundreds of thousands of people for the mild ailments in a small village. I have high regards for a doctor who is treating 1,000 people per day in a village than a doctor sitting in UK treating one surgery for 1 month. It's your perspective, how you see the world. So outside it looks so nice for me to go in a big car and come around, it looks so great. But you selection of the branch after you miss your medicine is just nothing. I have seen people who have joined medicine, who have left the medicine in the middle. I have seen people who have joined medicine, came over into the IAS or IPS branch and became a collector. And I have seen people who have discontinued medicine and came down to take care of the later business. So it is always your perspective of your life. So once you have taken up a decision, you should stand upon your decision how you want to survive. So how you want to survive is your always your personal thing. So if you are joined here, you need to put your 100% effort. And this is the branch which I am giving you confidence that it will be having a very good prospect in the future. Prospects of a branch is always important. So there are branches which the prospects have come down. There are branches which the prospects have improved. There was days when a general surgeon was the most earning branch in the medical field. But no, general surgeon has no work now because the branch has diversified into 20 branches. General surgery has become into plastic surgery, this surgery, gastro surgery, brain surgery, stomach surgery, anal surgery, this surgery. So people never thought that in the initial days of my life, the first duty of medicine, you feel like you need to become general surgeon. So otherwise orthopedics, because it's any branch, you don't need to go super specialty. So that's always how you take it. But once you've taken up this field, this field has prospects are still growing day by day. And your need for the society and for the corporate world is increasing day by day. Either because of the increased lifestyle diseases, you see a lot of people with diabetes, hypertension, a lot of people with obesity, a lot of people with chronic conditions, knee pains, fat. These are all people who require your support to gain their moral confidence, their diet regulations, and their lifestyle back into normal. Such if you, what the doctor is providing you as to a patient with a painkiller or a surgery, you are giving it with a lifestyle modification as a lifestyle coach or a lifestyle nutritionist. So your respect should be rewarded by yourself. So it is rewarded branch. Until unless you are introvert, you feel that you are in a smaller branch. There is bullshit to think in that. You are giving, see, your therapy has improved him. Your therapy has given him some quality of life. Your therapy has made his life a little feasible. You should be the most happiest man. You can't compare to someone who is doing something. He has his own difficulties in those branches. So don't think that everybody is happy. Everyone will have their own pressure. But this is my personal perspective to increase your confidence in your branch. So if you know this truth, you will definitely succeed in your life. But prospects of your branch is ever growing. Only thing is, in our place, in our hometown, yeah, it's still evolving. Because the economic financial balance in the hospital sector, hospitality sector is quite disturbed. So probably few years, maybe the demand is little sluggish. I don't say no, it is sluggish. But after few years, the demand becomes so huge. You know that any endocrinologist in any place, in any part of the world, will have a separate dietitian or nutritionist staying with him. She is the one who describes what should be eaten or what should not be eaten for the diabetic patient or the hypertensive patient or any hormone imbalance patient. That is evolving. So there are consultants in even Visakhapatnam who does those things. There are lifestyle coaches who charge quite hefty for doing this. So obviously, this is the 1 in 100, that's what you need to be. For that, this is a good base. This is a good base where the prospects of the success is quite huge. Day by day, things evolve very fast. So if you prevent the patient coming down to the doctor by lifestyle modifications, definitely patient will choose you than me. Because patient has bad opinion on me than you. He has a good opinion on you. Because you are not using any chemicals or something, they feel that we give medicines and we destroy their health. So you have a very good border prospectively. The patient has a very positive aura on you. So if you have a positive aura, you should be very confident that you are going to succeed. Yeah, since the field is evolving, you don't know where you stand initially. But your focus should be quite for the long term. You will succeed very well. You know, there are official super specialty programs in UK for nutritionist in nutraceutical industry. I have my cousin who has done that. He has done in clinical nutrition. He works in a big corporate company, in pharma companies and all. The prospect is quite good. So the things evolve. The pharma boom, which has created 20 years back in India, which was created most of the Andhra people only, has changed the prospect of B pharmacy. Initially, B pharmacy was felt like the second degree because why go on to the medical shop? So pharmacy people, after doing this specialty, they have grown into a good part. So every branch has its own pros and cons. So my branch, if I have one failure, lifelong the patient screws me. So that is not a branch which you need to go and get your skill. So yeah, definitely it is a very good branch. The prospect is good. But only thing is, you should keep your morale high. See, my branch took 16 years to make me sit here and talk with your CMD, sir. Before 16 years, I have nothing. So, but you should be happy within 4 years or 5 years, your degree is completed, 2 years of experience, you are going to gain the enough confidence to do what you want to do. So it's a small journey, so you should be ready for it.
Thank you very much, sir. So definitely, we have to appreciate your patience. Now I understand these many hours how you are doing surgery. So since 1.5 hours you are continuously asking. I think almost. So it went on just like that. I hope most of the questions he answered. And I need one question even from the boys. Because tomorrow, all the boys are sitting back, and anyone, one question from the boys also. And that will be the last question.
I'm interested.
Good morning, sir. This is Saima from FN20. Sir, my question to you is, which region of the spine is highly vulnerable?
Which region of the spine?
Thoracic, carnosal, or lumbar?
The spine can be divided into three. So you know that, I'm very happy. So cervical is the neck region. Thoracic is your upper back region, lumbar is the lower back region. That's how you differentiate spine. Each spine is prone for each kind of condition. The most common conditions like spondylitis, in studying population or software people or who work in bend, they are prone for cervical spondylitis. The people who work, who sit for longer time, who stand for longer time, they are prone for lumbar regions. So the people who are prone for accidents, who are having a spine fractures, the most common is thoracic regions. So each problem has its own region to be affected. So usually now at the present scenario, we see of your age group,
the most commonest complication is the neck, and the second most common is the lower back. So lumbar and cervical are the most common areas we see something called degenerative spondylitis. Degenerative spondylitis is arugudal. Arugudal means because of your posture, because of your bad health or bad physical activity, the commonest affected area is your cervical area, then is your lumbar area. Lumbar area for longer time sitting like me for 2 hours or 3 hours, definitely your back muscles will be affected. So these two areas are the most commonest area affected for degenerative things. So age related things are mostly affected for these things. Fractures are more for thoracic, the upper back areas. Upper back will be less common than cervical and lumbar.
So I hope all the questions are clarified. And this is only the starting. And we need many more sessions like this, sir. So we are expecting you to come. This is like your own college, so you can come at any time and you can talk to our students.
If students, they want me, I'll definitely come.
Yes, sir.
So they're very active. And one thing I like is, I have seen Kaun Banega Crorepati program also. So he gave options also. So instead of troubling. So my boys will be very flexible and very easy that they don't want to trouble others. So we gave plenty of options. One thing, when he's answering to the questions, all the students, they're responding with eyes, ears. The way you're watching. And when he's talking about each and every topic, when some words come in between, few people are responding. That means the knowledge what you have is really, I have to appreciate you people. I thought it is only the bookish knowledge you have, but practically you are so improved. So I thank all the faculty members, your principal madam, for supporting you in that way and to train you in such a way. And I need more preparation from you girls and boys. So many other doctors also will come. And definitely we'll have a workshop probably in the month of December or in the month of Jan. So more doctors will be here. So we have to respect all of them. And on this occasion, so we have to appreciate all the doctors in India, of course in the world, who has treated the patients in this pandemic situation. So people are running away with this COVID virus. But only the doctors are frontline warriors. Of course, the remaining people also there. But they are the frontline warriors who has taken a lot of care about all the patients. Today, India is still alive. And one of the reasons is doctors. So we all know. He said one thing. So respect has to be there to each and every department. Of course, every nutritionist, they need their respect. Every food technologist, they need their respect. And every doctor, they need their respect. Not only one profession, all the professions are great, but we will be the tomorrow's generation, no doubt about it. Because without nutritionists, without food technologists, our countries will not survive. And you know one thing? When doctors treated all the patients in the hospitals in this COVID time, most of the patients recovered only because of the food and diet. Of course, without doctor, they'll not survive. But the main thing is, with the food, they survive. That's what the importance you people have. So don't worry about the future. That'll be a great privilege, sir. So. Very good information you gave to all the students. We are very happy for that. And now I request Vijayalakshmi Madam also to say a few words and let's end up the session.
Spare your valuable time to clear some doubts of our students. And your humble words and everything is very important for our students because you concentrate more on their career orientation. And you told more points than what we used to say them. And sir, one more thing, Actually, today I learned some new things from the perinutrition, which is something I don't know about that one. It happened before, during
the operating nutrition. Peri operating nutrition.
That's what I am very happy to learn that new word from the doctor today. Like that, I wish you people also have that, what that the tendency to take one point every day, new point from the your surroundings, from college or friends or whatever, you teach us something, that will be very helpful for you. Because this will remember and it will help us a lot. Like that I used to get, and today I am very happy to come here, and I should say thanks to our sir also to bring you to here. And one more thing, sir, I am having a back-to-back problem because of the laptop and all, I used to spend most of the time. So like this, I definitely will come to your thing. And I was doctor. And one more thing, sir, as you said that every endocrinologist here, one Dileep Kumar endocrinologist, he is having one Usha Gajpati as a dietitian. Like each and every doctor, you can work as a nutritionist, not only in the government sector and all, doctors and each and every hospital, even in Vizag also, but not that much lucrative as in other what doctors hold in abroad and all, but here also you are getting very good opportunities somehow. And your course is one of the best course what you have selected. That's what I used to say every time, and for you also, same doctor highlighted very more points to you, got cleared all of your doubts, and I also got very good knowledge from you, sir, by attending this one. I say thank you very much for you to attend this one, spare your time for us.
And Vijayalakshmi ma'am and my staff and my dear students, very good afternoon, everyone. Really, the session very wonderful and it is informative. So when we ask, generally when we consulted after, when we ask one question or 10 questions, so they will give any one or two suggestions like or answers. But you covered entire information regarding the term what they use, sir. So very, very nice and very informative. And I never see a doctor like this, sir. And we are very happy and thank you for enlightening our students, sir. Thank you so much.
When we go to the doctor, we will tell you 120 medicines and we will ask 100 questions. And they will give only one answer. That one is, you just use these medicines, it will be cured. Because they will have a lot of patients. But the first doctor, what I have seen in his clinic, in his hospital, he'll give 10 medicines and he'll speak 100. And patient, you know, every patient, when they go to the hospital, the problem will be cured with his voice. Very sweetly he'll say, no, it's a very small operation. And within next day, you can go to your home. Patient will feel very happy. Now, recently, one of my known person, he went with the surgery. I know it is a very difficult surgery. It took near about 4 hours time, 3 to 4 hours time. And I thought it take minimum 4 to 5 days. So he sent me the video. Within 12 hours, he's walking and he has taken the video. The patient telling in that video, see, I'm not lying, I'm very happy. I'm walking, I'm like this today only because of you. See, this happens very rarely. We have to remember one point. After surgery, we will face the surgery pain for days and days. There are doctors, we have to appreciate them. We have a negative impact that doctors will treat only commercially. But India proved that in this COVID situation, they are not commercial, they are helpful. Only because of them, today India is still like this. And he is one and one there. So thank you. Thank you very much, sir. As you said, we all respect all the doctors, and from today, more interest will be there on all the doctors. Definitely we will like all the doctors, and thank you for all your time. A doctor spending this much time in our class is very difficult, but you are here today. I thank my faculty and other team members also for arranging such a nice session.
And thank you for all the students. Your question, the questions what you asked really informative. And not only you people, many people in the society also tomorrow, maybe from the social websites, they'll listen to the words of the sir and they'll listen to your questions. And they have all these doubts, so all these doubts will be cleared. So these kind of sessions, we want to conduct more in this Southern Academy. So I thank the director, madam, and the remaining fraternity also for arranging such a kind of nice session. And at last, I'd like to call my student for giving vote of thanks and to end the session. Thank you.
Good afternoon, sir. This is M. Rishisha from Food Science and Nutrition. Thank you, sir, for attending our seminar today. We are so glad that you accepted our cordial invitation and came here to embrace us. We are greatly honored as you could spare time from your busy schedule despite this pandemic to inspire us by sharing your experiences. Your seminar is so informative and helpful us. Thank you, sir. We will forever be grateful to you. Thank you for management as well as faculty. We are always support you and always trying to bring out the best in us. Thank you, sir.